to reduce the clutter on your table, you need a direction. So something like Prepladder gives us that direction. You have some 40 hours or 50 hours of
I have given all the content of pharmacology.
I have contributed the entire content for internal medicine.
I have created the content for PSM.
You can trust the questions and explanations to be genuine.
Detailed explanations will help you solve the different variations of the same question.
Textbook references will help you authenticate an answer.
I have created this content after close inspection of the previous year questions.
I have put in my 14 years of experience into creating these questions.
Includes the latest exam questions, questions on the recent updates, as well as the image-based questions.
All questions are according to recent exam trends and difficulty level.
So the software would be exactly like the real exam.
All your queries come directly to me.
So if you have any kind of doubt, you can ask me directly.
I'll be solving all your microbiology related queries.
You can ask anything about the subject, doesn't have to be only about a question.
I'm always available for you whenever you need help.
You can have a counseling session with me.
So we've put in features to make sure you keep studying. The Prepladder app will never let you fall behind.
Solving obs and gynec questions will be easy for you after this.
You would not have to worry about anatomy at all.
You'll be able to solve most of the questions in PSM.
Most pathology questions in the exams are going to be derivatives or the repeats from these questions.
1 lakh competitors.
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 It's good to see that everyone in the team is giving their best.
This is the best team of faculties that could have been put together.
This is the biggest innovation in medical education.
We are obsessed with making sure that you get the best value out of every minute spent on the Prepladder app.
Really happy to be a part of Team Prepladder.
You know, if there was something like Prepladder when I was preparing, I'm sure that I would have prepared much better because I would have known what to read.
Risk factors for breast cancer. Risk factors for breast cancer. First of all, advancing age. Second, origin, Western countries. Third, high socioeconomic status. Fourth, alcohol intake. Fifth, high fat diet. And it can lead to obviously obesity. And sixth, state of hyperestrogenemia. What are the states of hyperestrogenemia? Have a look. Early menarche, late menopause, nulliparity, and late first full term pregnancy. Late first full term pregnancy. So these are states of hyperestrogenemia. After that, Other risk factors are 7th, positive family history. Means the mother of the patient is having breast cancer, sister is having breast cancer, her aunt is having breast cancer. 8th, genetic mutations. And you know, one of the very important mutation responsible for breast cancer, that is BRCA. In BRCA, there are two mutations, BRCA1 and BRCA2. One question which is frequently asked, which one is mainly responsible for female breast cancer and which one is mainly responsible for male breast cancer? BRCA1 is mainly responsible for female breast cancer and BRCA2 mainly responsible for male breast cancer. So how to remember? Simple. Ladies first. So we have to remember ladies first. So BRCA1 mainly for female breast cancer, BRCA2 mainly for male breast cancer. After that, 9th, personal history of malignancy. So personal history of malignancy. So what are those malignancies in females which increases the risk of breast cancer? First, ovarian cancer. And second is endometrial cancer. After that, 10th, hormone replacement therapy. Hormone replacement therapy. After that, 11th, therapeutic radiation exposure. Now, what is the meaning of therapeutic radiation exposure? Yes, it is usually 40 to 60 gray of radiation, which is usually curative or used for the treatment of some malignancy. So, this much radiation exposure. So, that is therapeutic radiation exposure. All these are risk factors for carcinoma breast. And you can see most of these risk factors are revolving around high socioeconomic status. One very important question, that breastfeeding is protective or it's not protective? Long duration of breastfeeding is protective for breast cancer. Long duration of breastfeeding is protective for breast cancer. So these are the risk factors. We are going to discuss breast cancer in detail. So first of all, what is the most common histological type in breast cancer? I already told you, it is adenocarcinoma. So most common histological type is adenocarcinoma. After that, what is the most common subtype? That is invasive ductal cancer. Nowadays, in most of the recent exams, you have seen that the questions are being asked about least common, like least common type, least malignant. So, question, least common. This is the latest question. Least common type of breast cancer. This is the latest question, and that is papillary. After that simple question, what is the most malignant type of breast cancer? Is inflammatory breast cancer. So question is asked, what is the least malignant? Most malignant is inflammatory breast cancer. So what is least malignant type of breast cancer or breast cancer with best prognosis? And that is tubular. Again, this is the latest question. These are two latest questions. I'm repeating. Least common type is papillary, and least malignant or type of breast cancer having best prognosis, that is tubular. After that, one question which is frequently asked, what's the most common site of breast cancer? So see, this is the diagram of breast. Okay, in this, these are the quadrants of breast. In this, simple question is asked, what is the most common site? And you know, that is upper outer quadrant. Why? Because in this, there is maximum amount of breast tissue. That's why it's the most common site. So simple question is asked, what is the least common site? And you can see here, least amount of breast tissue is present in lower inner quadrant. So that is lower inner quadrant. And this is least common site. Again, this is the latest question. After that, questions are asked about what is the most common route of spread in breast cancer. Most common route of spread is hematogenous. So question is asked, what is the most common site of metastasis? And the most common site of metastasis is bone. So question is asked, which bone? Yes, it is more common in, most common site is lumbar vertebra, followed by femur, followed by thoracic vertebra. So how to remember this? Very simple. The mnemonic is LFT. Lumbar vertebra, followed by femur, followed by thoracic vertebra. What is the most common cause of death? Most common cause of death in breast cancer is malignant pleural effusion. So that is malignant pleural effusion. Right? These are the questions which are frequently asked. After that, there is one very, very important topic in breast cancer. What is the pathway of spread of breast cancer cell? Now see, it's very important. Have a look. Pathway of spread in breast cancer. So initially, this is breast cancer cell. It is going to invade posterior intercostal vein. After posterior intercostal vein, there is involvement of Batson plexus. After this Batson plexus involvement, there are two routes. It can invade the or involve the lumbar vertebra, or it can involve dural venous sinuses. From dural venous sinuses, there is involvement of leptomeninges. And from leptomeningeal involvement, there is involvement of what? Brain. This is very important. Why? You can see lots of questions are asked from this simple flowchart. See the first question. What is the vein via which there is involvement of Batson plexus? That is posterior intercostal vein. Second question, lumbar vertebra or vertebral column in CA breast is involved by or via which plexus? Batson plexus. What is the most common site of metastasis in CA breast? This is the third question, lumbar vertebra. leptomeninges are involved via which vein? That's dural venous sinuses. And CA breast is most common primary. Is most common primary for leptomeningeal metastasis. What is the meaning of primary? Primary means where malignancy is going to arise. And what is the meaning of secondary? Where it is going to metastasize. So, I'm repeating, most common primary responsible for leptomeningeal metastasis, and that is CA breast. Second question, most common primary responsible for metastasis to brain, and this is carcinoma lung followed by carcinoma breast. So, this is sixth question. This is sixth question. So, these are the questions which are asked frequently. Out of this, what you have noticed, via Batson plexus, the malignancy is going to invade lumbar vertebra also and dural venous sinuses also. How it is possible that malignant cells are going down also and it is going up also? Because there are some veins which are valveless. And how to remember? What are the veins which are valveless? There is a mnemonic, that is IPSBD is valveless. So, what is this IPSBD? IVC, P, portal vein, S, SVC, B, Batson plexus, and D, dural venous sinuses. So, I'm repeating, inferior vena cava, portal vein, superior vena cava, Batson plexus, and dural venous sinuses. All these are valveless veins. So, you can see here, via Batson plexus and via dural venous sinuses, there is involvement of leptomeninges and brain. So, this is pathway of spread of breast cancer cell. Now, coming to the clinical presentation. So, all of you must be knowing what is the most common presentation of CA breast, and that is breast lump. If the female is educated doing self-palpation, she might come to you at early stage having a lump in the breast. But suppose she is not very much concerned and she is coming to you in advanced stages, in that case what will happen? This malignancy is going to involve nipple, going to involve breast skin, and it is going to involve chest wall. Sometimes the tumor cells are going to enter into lymphatics, and because of this there is lymphatic obstruction. And because of this lymphatic obstruction or lymphatic permeation by tumor cells, there is pudorine, that is cutaneous edema. That cutaneous edema is known as pudorine. Clear? So, these are the presentations. I am repeating again. Most common presentation is breast lump. Other presentations are involvement of nipple leading to nipple retraction, nipple deviation, nipple ulceration, fixity to chest wall, and skin thickening. Right? And if there is lymphatic permeation by tumor cells, it can lead to pudorine. These are the presentations. Sometimes breast cancer lead to metastasis, and then patients are coming to us with metastatic breast cancer. In those cases, patient is having backache, headache, sometimes jaundice, sometimes abdominal distension because of metastasis. So this is the presentation. After that, questions are asked. What is the first investigation done in patients of breast cancer, in suspected case of breast cancer? And I already told you that's mammography. I'm repeating. What is the first investigation done in a suspected case of breast cancer? Mammography. After that, question is asked, investigation of choice for diagnosis of breast cancer. And that is biopsy. Right? Okay. After that, one frequently asked question in exam is triple assessment. So, what are the components of triple assessment? First is clinical, signs and symptoms, second, imaging. In imaging, ultrasound or mammography. And third, tissue sampling. Tissue sampling. And that is what? FNAC or biopsy. So, this is triple assessment. Three components are there. And the positive predictive value or accuracy of this triple assessment is 99.9%. This is a frequently asked question. Positive predictive value or accuracy of triple assessment is 99.9%. Before discussing anything further, I should tell you something about the investigations. So first, let's see what are the differences between FNAC and biopsy. So differences between FNAC and biopsy, FNAC and biopsy. So first question, what is the full form of FNAC? That is fine needle aspiration cytology. And what are the other names of biopsy? It is known as true cut biopsy, core cut biopsy or needle biopsy, because it is performed with the help of a needle. In FNAC, questions are asked, what's the size of FNAC needle? It is 22 to 26 gauge. Okay. Since in FNAC only cells are being assessed, requirement is there. Requirement of experienced cytopathologist. So, experienced cytopathologist is required to confirm the diagnosis. Second problem, in FNAC, only cells are being assessed. Basement membrane is not visualized. That's why it is difficult to differentiate DCIS from invasive ductal cancer. So, it is difficult to differentiate DCIS from invasive ductal cancer. It means there are high chances of false positive or false negative results. And second problem, since only cells are being assessed, it is difficult to assess hormone receptor status. So, it is difficult to assess hormone receptor status. Right? Now, see the advantages of biopsy over FNAC. First, In this biopsy, we are going to assess the chunk of tissue. It means easy to differentiate ductal carcinoma in situ from invasive ductal cancer. And second, it is easy to assess hormone receptor status. Right? The only problem is biopsy is more painful. And that's why I told you investigation of choice for diagnosis of breast cancer is biopsy, also known as true cut biopsy, core cut biopsy or needle biopsy. Right? Okay. After that, mammography is frequently asked nowadays in exam. We are going to discuss in detail mammography. So, first question. It is investigation of choice for screening of breast cancer. Next, it is recommended in all the females. At age 40 years. So, it should be started at the age 40. After 40, annual mammography is recommended. Lots of questions are asked regarding radiation exposure in mammography. What is the radiation exposure? The mammography, in mammography, radiation exposure is 0.1 centigrade per study. Another question which is frequently asked, one mammography is equal to how many chest x-ray? One mammography is equal to 4 chest x-ray. So, these are two frequently asked questions. Now, in mammography, what happens? There are two views. One is this craniocaudal view, craniocaudal, and one is this mediolateral oblique view. Now, you can see in craniocaudal view, this is the view, craniocaudal. In this, what I'm going to assess? This aspect of breast. What is this aspect? This is medial aspect of breast. Simultaneously, the breast is going to rest on the plates and I'm going to assess the breast compression also. Simultaneously, in mediolateral oblique view, we are going to assess the maximum amount of breast tissue and this tail. What's the name of this tail? This is known as axillary tail of Spence. So, I'm repeating. In craniocaudal view, medial aspect of breast, is best assessed and breast compression. And in mediolateral oblique view, that is known as MLO view, maximum amount of breast tissue is assessed simultaneously axillary tail of Spence. Clear? So, these are assessed in these two views. Okay. Now, what is the role of mammography? Suppose some female is having a breast lump, she will be coming to you, right? But what is the role of mammography? It can diagnose non-palpable breast cancer. So if it can diagnose non-palpable breast cancer, it means it can diagnose malignancy at early stage. Malignancy will be treated at early stage, and that's why the prognosis will be better as compared to the malignancies which are diagnosed at late stage, treated at late stage. So just because of early detection or early diagnosis, it is going to improve survival and it is going to decrease mortality. It improves survival, decreases mortality. How much? More than 33%. That's why it's recommended in all the females at age 40, and annual mammography is recommended after 40. Okay, how we are going to differentiate on mammography that the lesion is benign or the lesion is malignant, right? Now just have a look of this picture. Suppose this is breast, this is nipple. What we can see in mammography? We can see the opacity of tumor. What we can see? We can easily detect whether there is nipple retraction or deviation. We can see whether there is skin thickening or not. And simultaneously, what else we can see? We can see that whether there is obliteration of retromammary space. Obliteration of retromammary space. Now you can see, I'm repeating it again. On mammography, what I can visualize the opacity, nipple retraction, skin thickening, and obliteration of retromammary space. These changes are usually seen in malignancy. These changes are usually not seen in benign disorders. So see how we are going to differentiate benign disorders from malignancy. Simple. So have a look. This is benign. And this is malignant. Now, in benign disorders, opacity is having regular margin. It is smooth, homogeneous, having low density and thin halo. What do you mean by thin halo? Suppose this is the opacity. Around opacity, this kind of empty appearance. This is known as halo. Now in malignancy, see what are the changes. In malignancy, these are the changes. About opacity, obviously it is irregular. You have to remember three words which are usually asked in exam. What are those three words which you have to remember? Stellate, speculate, comet tail, margin. These three words should be remembered. Stellate, speculate, comet tail, margin. Rest is just opposite. They are homogeneous. So here it is heterogeneous. In benign, it is having low density. Here it is having high density. In benign disorders, there is thin halo. Here there is wide halo. The second question is asked about the calcification. You know that in benign disorders there is macrocalcification. Question is asked, what is macrocalcification? The size of calcification should be more than 0.5 mm. But in malignancy, there is microcalcification. So question is asked, what is the size of calcification? It should be less than 0.5 mm. These are the differences. After that, associated changes in the breast. See, this is benign. This is malignant. So, associated changes in the breast are absent, whereas it is present, like there will be nipple retraction. You can see this on mammography. You can find that there is skin thickening and there is obliteration. Obliteration of retromammary space. So I'm repeating, in benign disorders, associated changes in the breast are absent, but in malignancy, it's present, like nipple retraction, skin thickening, obliteration of retromammary space. So these are the differences between benign disorders and malignancy. After that, if you have seen mammography report, there is one score given in the report for individual breast. And what's the name? The name is BI-RADS. So the question is asked first that what's the full form of BI-RADS? This was asked many times. Full form? It is breast imaging reporting and data system. Breast imaging reporting and data system. Now see the categories and their description. Category 0. What is 0? Here, be careful, here mammography is zero. It means there is incomplete assessment. By mammography, so what is required? Additional imaging is required. After that, category 1. Here, mammography is negative. And if mammography is negative, what advice should be given? Annual mammography is recommended. Annual mammography is recommended. Category 2. It is benign. And if it's benign, again, what advice? Same. Annual mammography is recommended. After that, category 3. 3 is probably benign. And if it's probably benign, then short-term follow-up. Is advised. Category 4. Suspicious. And if there is a suspicious lesion, what is recommended? Biopsy. Biopsy is recommended. Category 5. Highly suggestive. And if it's highly suggestive of malignancy, what should be performed? Intervention. So, intervention is recommended. And if it is category 6, it means it's biopsy proven malignancy. So this is biopsy proven malignancy. Clear? Okay. So these are the 6 categories. Any patient who is going to be sent for mammography, in this she will be having Bi-RADS score for each breast separately. You must be thinking that if there is biopsy proven malignancy, what's the role of mammography? Now just imagine. Imagine that from a rural area, some female is referred by a pathologist. Why? Because she was having a lump in the left breast. Where was the lump? Lump was in the upper outer quadrant. He diagnosed that this is malignant. Patient is referred to your hospital. You have the biopsy report, but still you will go for mammography. Why? Because I don't know the status of other quadrants of same breast. Patient might be having malignancy in other quadrants also. And second, I want to rule out malignancy in other quadrants of contralateral breast. That's why even in biopsy proven malignancy, mammography is mandatory. Why? To rule out malignancy in other quadrants of same breast and to rule out malignancy in contralateral breast. Nowadays, there are 2-3 new questions which are asked about Bi-RADS or the similar questions about Bi-RADS. Now see, one I told you, that's Bi-RADS. So for breast, there is Bi-RADS. And it is based on which investigation? Mammography. Similarly, there is Thyroids. This Thyroids is for thyroid. So, what's the full form of Thyroids? Again, similar, thyroid, imaging, reporting, and data system. It is based on sonography. That is ultrasound. Similarly, for prostate, there is Pi-RADS. And this is based on MRI. So, what is the full form of Pi-RADS? Prostate, imaging, reporting, and data system. These are the latest pattern of questions being asked nowadays. So, this is mammography. After mammography, one question which is asked frequently, that what is the investigation of choice for screening of breast cancer in high-risk females? What do you mean by high-risk female? High-risk female means having positive family history or having BRCA mutation. So the question is, investigation of choice for screening of breast cancer in high-risk females. And that's MRI. What's the definition of high-risk female? High-risk female means having positive family history or having BRCA mutation. And the classical example is, you must be knowing Angelina Jolie. She was having BRCA1 mutation and her aunt was having breast cancer. Second question, which is frequently asked, investigation of choice for diagnosis of implant-related complications. Means breast implant related complications. And again, it's what MRI.
Third question. This was asked in one exam. Question was, most sensitive investigation for diagnosis of DCIS. Options are MRI and second option is mammography. The correct answer is what? MRI. So I'm repeating the question. Most sensitive investigation for diagnosis of DCIS, that is mammography. Sorry. Most sensitive investigation for diagnosis of DCIS is MRI. After that, a question is asked. Most sensitive investigation for microcalcifications of DCIS. For microcalcification of DCIS, most sensitive investigation is mammography. So be careful what is exactly asked in the exam. So these are the indications of MRI. After that, questions are asked about ultrasound. In which patient generally mammography is not recommended? Usually, mammography is not recommended in the females less than 35 years of age. Why? Because the breast is dense and glandular. Because of dense and glandular breast, the sensitivity of mammography is low. So the question is asked, what is the first investigation done in a young female less than 35 years of age with breast lump, and that is ultrasound? I'm repeating, first investigation done in a young female less than 35 years with breast lump, that is ultrasound. So these are battery of investigations performed for breast cancer. Sometimes questions are asked about PET scan. That what's the role of PET scan? And the PET scan is basically used for diagnosis of distant metastasis. And it is used to differentiate scarring, fibrosis, necrosis from recurrence. Now, how to understand? It's very simple. Suppose in some female there is locally advanced breast cancer, and what treatment was given? Neoadjuvant chemotherapy plus modified radical mastectomy plus radiotherapy. In the follow-up, after 4 to 6 months, she is coming to you saying that, sir, I can feel a nodule in this region. And if you are going to feel, you are also going to feel a nodule. So how you are going to differentiate whether this is recurrence or this is scarring or fibrosis? So I will go for PET scan. So that's why this PET scan is used to differentiate scarring, fibrosis, necrosis from recurrence. So these are the investigations which are performed in patients of carcinoma breast. 8th AJCC TNM classification for carcinoma breast. So see, 8th
AJCC, TNM classification. For carcinoma breast, T1, size of tumor up to 2 cm. Be careful, it is up to 2 cm. It is not less than 2 cm. It is up to 2 cm. T2 is more than 2 to 5 cm. T3 is more than 5 cm. T4A is extension to chest wall. Now the question is asked, what are the components of chest wall? Chest wall is found by ribs plus intercostal muscles plus serratus anterior. Be careful, pectoralis major and pectoralis minor is not the part of chest wall, and that's why involvement of pectoralis major and minor doesn't affect the staging in CA breast. T4B is edema including pudiorange, ulceration and satellite nodules. Be careful, nipple retraction, dimpling, involvement of dermis. Nipple retraction, dimpling, involvement of dermis is not included in T4B. T4C is both T4A plus T4B. And what is T4D? T4D is inflammatory breast cancer. So this is T. After that, lymph node or N. So lymph node or N staging, N1 is metastasis to ipsilateral, axillary lymph node level 1 and 2, which is mobile. What is N2A? Is same almost, metastasis to ipsilateral axillary lymph node level 1, 2, but it is fixed or matted. N2B is clinically apparent. Internal mammary nodes. So question is asked, what is clinically apparent internal mammary nodes? Clinically apparent internal mammary nodes means detected on clinical examination or on imaging except lymphoscintigraphy or grossly visible pathologically. After that, N3A, that is metastasis to ipsilateral infraclavicular lymph node. After that, N3B, metastasis to ipsilateral axillary plus internal mammary nodes. after that N3C, metastasis to ipsilateral supraclavicular lymph node. So this is lymph node staging. After that, easiest staging is metastasis. M0, no metastasis, and M1, metastasis. Right? So this is TNM classification. After that, very important is the staging of CA breast. So see the staging part also. Staging. Stage 1 is T1. Stage 2A is T021 N1 and T2. Stage 2B, that is T2N1 and T3. Stage 3A, T022 N2, T3 N122. After that, stage 3B, T4 N022 and stage 3C, TNE N3. And stage 4, TNE, NNE, M1. This is the staging and this is actually very easy. Now, how to remember? See how to remember the staging of CA breast. Very simple, have a look. Just see these encircled stages. These are the characteristic features. If it is M1, it will be stage 4. If it is N3, it's stage 3C. And if it is T4, it is stage 3B. After that, see these stages. This is 1, this is 2, this is 3, and this is 4. Now, what is this 1, 2, 3, 4? 1. 1 plus 1, 2. 2 plus 1, 3. 2 plus 2, 3 plus 1, 4. I'm repeating. Can you see? T1, that is 1. T021 N1, 1 plus 1, 2, and second is T2, that is also 2, 2 plus 1, that is 3 in 2B, and here you can see 2 plus 2 or 3 plus 1, that is 4. So this is very easy staging, you have to remember. After that, some special situations are there. Now see the special situations in CA breast. Suppose in the breast, there are two lumps. How we will stage that condition? If two lumps are there in the same breast, staging is based on the bigger lump. Second situation, if the patient is having breast lump in each breast, in this case, each breast staging will be done separately. And third special situation, if a patient is having breast cancer with involvement of contralateral axillary lymph node. Involvement of contralateral axillary lymph node is suggestive of metastasis. So we have to think that this is metastasis. So these are three special situations of breast cancer staging. Management of breast cancer, which is very, very important. So have a look of management of breast cancer. Depending upon the stage, first, early invasive breast cancer. In early invasive breast cancer, the stages included are 1, 2A, 2B. And what are the treatment options? Preferred treatment option is breast conservation surgery plus axillary lymph node sampling plus radiotherapy. And if there is any contraindication
of breast conservation surgery, in those cases, we have to go for simple or total mastectomy. Simple mastectomy is also known as total mastectomy, plus axillary lymph node sampling. Clear? So, questions are asked that what are the indications of chemotherapy in early invasive breast cancer? So, indications of chemotherapy in early invasive breast cancer. First, high histological grade. Second, lymphovascular invasion. Third, hormone receptor negative. Hormone receptor means estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor. And fourth, HER2-new. HER2-new is positive. These are the indications in which chemotherapy should be given in patients of early invasive breast cancer. And all of you must be knowing, the patients who are having positive estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor, usually hormone therapy is given. And if HER2-new receptor is positive, in that case, we give one drug known as trastuzumab or Herceptin. So for HER2-new positive breast cancer, trastuzumab or Herceptin is given. This is the treatment for early invasive breast cancer. After that, have a look of treatment for locally advanced breast cancer, LABC. The stage in locally advanced breast cancer is stage 3A, 3B and 3C. Our first principle in this case is to downstage the tumor by neoadjuvant chemotherapy. After that, we have to remove the tumor, that is modified radical mastectomy. And for loco-regional control, we have to give what? Radiotherapy. So the treatment is neoadjuvant chemotherapy plus MRM plus radiotherapy. So neoadjuvant chemotherapy plus modified radical mastectomy plus radiotherapy. This is the treatment for locally advanced breast cancer. After that, what is the treatment for metastatic breast cancer? And in metastatic breast cancer, the stage is 4. So this is stage 4. In patients of metastasis, we have to follow two principles. What are those principles? First, prolong the survival. And second, improve the quality of life. So have a look. We have to prolong the survival and improve the quality of life. For metastatic breast cancer, we have two forms of treatment available. One is hormone therapy and second is chemotherapy. Obviously, chemotherapy is having lots of side effects as compared to hormone therapy. And that's why hormone therapy is preferred over chemotherapy. So see the indications of hormone therapy and chemotherapy. Indications: hormone therapy. Obviously, ER/PR should be positive. Second, asymptomatic visceral metastasis. And third, bony or soft tissue metastasis. These are the indications of hormone therapy. Now have a look of indications of chemotherapy. So first common sense indication of chemotherapy, it's very obvious what ER, PR should be negative. Second common sense indications, you can see symptomatic visceral metastasis. And third is hormone refractory. Hormone refractory means patient is not responding to hormone therapy even after 3 endocrine regimens. Even after 3 endocrine regimens, patient is not responding. So these are indications of hormone therapy and chemotherapy. By the way, usually hormone therapy is preferred over chemotherapy because it is associated with lesser side effects. After that, frequently one question is asked, what are the indications of radiotherapy in CA breast? So have a look. Indications of radiotherapy in CA breast. First, we discussed what? Breast conservation surgery. Second, I already told you locally advanced breast cancer. Why? For loco-regional control. And third, this was asked in an entrance exam. The question was, how many lymph nodes should be positive? So, 4 or more positive lymph nodes. And fourth, positive margins. These are the indications of radiotherapy. What is the meaning of positive margins? Have a look. Suppose in a patient, mastectomy is performed. This is breast, this is nipple areola, and this is the lung. Suppose mastectomy is performed and this kind of elliptical incision is given. This elliptical incision is given and you can see here we are going to remove nipple areola skin, breast tissue, breast mass. Pathologist is going to tell you that, sir, margin is positive. It means tumor is present at this margin. And if tumor is present at this margin, what does it mean? Tumor is also present at this margin, which is there in the patient's body. It means to kill those tumor cells, what you have to give? You have to give radiotherapy. So the indications of radiotherapy are breast conservation surgery, locally advanced breast cancer, 4 or more positive lymph nodes, and positive margins. So this is how we treat breast cancer. How we are going to perform mastectomy? See this diagram first. Very simple. This is breast. In this, there is nipple, there is areola, and there is breast mass. Right? How we are going to perform mastectomy? First, we have to give incision. And what kind of incision is given? In breast cancer, elliptical incision. In this, can you see, the skin overlying the lump should always be included in incision. I'm repeating, skin overlying the lump should always be included in the incision. And see what all structures we are removing here. It is end block removal of nipple, areola, breast tissue, breast mass, This is simple mastectomy or total mastectomy. So this is simple or total mastectomy. That is in block removal of nipple areola skin, breast tissue, breast mass. Right? After that, have a look. Extended mastectomy. Extended mastectomy is what? Simple mastectomy plus removal of level 1 lymph node. So it is simple mastectomy plus removal of level 1 lymph node. After that, modified radical mastectomy, that is MRM. MRM is in block removal of nipple areola skin, breast tissue, breast mass, plus level 1 and 2 lymph node. This is modified radical mastectomy. After that, there is Halsted radical mastectomy. In Halsted radical mastectomy, there is in block removal of nipple areola skin, breast tissue, breast mass, plus level 1, 2 and 3 lymph node, plus excision of pectoralis major and minor. There is excision of pectoralis major and minor. This is Halsted radical mastectomy. Frequently, questions are asked, what are the structures which are spared in Halsted radical mastectomy? And the mnemonic is A, B, C is spared. A, axillary vein. B, Bell's nerve. What is the other name of Bell's nerve? It is also known as long thoracic nerve. And C, cephalic vein. So these are the structures which are spared in Halsted radical mastectomy. After that, question is asked, what is extended radical mastectomy? So C, extended radical mastectomy. How to remember this? There is a mnemonic, RIM. Now what is RIM? R means radical mastectomy plus IM means removal of internal mammary nodes. So it is radical mastectomy plus removal of internal mammary nodes. Similarly, there is another question known as super radical mastectomy. Now what is this super radical mastectomy? Again, there is a mnemonic is radical mastectomy plus removal of SIM. Radical mastectomy plus removal of SIM. SIM means S, supraclavicular lymph node,
I means internal memory nodes. And M means mediastinal. Right? So super radical mastectomy is radical mastectomy plus removal of supraclavicular, internal mammary and mediastinal lymph nodes. These are the various types of mastectomy frequently asked in exam. After that, questions are asked regarding modifications of modified radical mastectomy or variants of MRM. First is Oshin clause. Oshin clause variant. It is same as MRM. After that, Petty's modification. Now see, Petty's wanted to remove level 3 lymph node. And you know, level 3 is apical. For removing level 3 lymph node, what he did? He excised pectoralis minor. So, Petty's modification is N block removal of nipple areola skin breast tissue breast mass plus level 1, 2, 3 lymph node plus excision of, be careful, excision of pectoralis minor. Scanlon also did the same thing, but rather than doing excision of pectoralis minor, he did division of pectoralis minor and then removal of level 3 lymph node. So have a look of Scanlon's modification. Scanlon's modification. This is N block removal of nipple areola skin breast tissue breast mass plus level 1, 2, 3 lymph node plus, be careful, division, not the excision, division, not the excision of pectoralis minor. So there is division, not the excision of pectoralis minor. These are the variants of MRM frequently asked nowadays. So this is mastectomy. Questions are frequently asked regarding breast reconstruction. So what are the methods of breast reconstruction? Have a look. Breast reconstruction. There are three methods. One is autogenous, in which patient's own tissues are used. Second, alloplastic, in which silicon gel implants or silicon implants with saline refill is used. And the third is combined, in which both of the methods are used, like flap plus implant. One by one we are going to discuss. Have a look. First of all, autogenous. In autogenous breast reconstruction, patient's own tissues are used. What are the flaps which are used? Tram flap. This is most commonly used flap. Transverse rectus abdominis muscle flap. Second is LD flap, that is latissimus dorsi flap. Third, thoracoepigastric flap. Fourth, lateral thigh flap. Fifth, gluteal flap. And sixth, Rubens flap. This Rubens flap is based on deep circumflex iliac artery. It is based on deep circumflex iliac artery. So these are the types of autogenous breast reconstruction in which you can see patient's own tissues are used. After that, alloplastic. In alloplastic breast reconstruction, there are two types. First, silicone gel implants. And second, silicone implants with saline refill. Silicone implants with saline refill. You must be knowing that silicone implants are the most common methods of breast reconstruction and breast augmentation worldwide. It is the silicone implants are the most common methods of breast augmentation and breast reconstruction worldwide. So see the placement of this implant. Just imagine that this is breast and this is what? Nipple. What is this? This is the pectoralis major. Now what I'm going to do? I'm going to perform mastectomy. After mastectomy, you can see what? This part of breast is removed. Then what is left? Here. This part of breast is removed. Now what is left? Only this part of skin. So there are two locations where we can place the implant. Either we can place it beneath skin or we can place it beneath pectoralis major. Be careful. The preferred location is which one? Beneath pectoralis major. So see, this is the skin. After that, this is the pectoralis major. And we are going to place the implant beneath pectoralis major. This is the preferred location. And you must be knowing, if there is any implant related complication, what is the investigation of choice for diagnosis? It is MRI. So MRI is investigation of choice for diagnosis of implant related complication. So this is alloplastic method. After that, combined method. Third, combine. Some females are having large breast. In those females, after mastectomy, it's very difficult to restore the symmetry only with the help of flap. That's why with the help of flap, we are also using the silicone implants. And this is what? Tram flap plus implant. And second is LD flap plus implant. So tram flap plus implant, LD flap plus implant. Transverse rectus abdominis muscle flap plus implant, latissimus dorsi flap plus implant. In which females we are using combined method? Females having large breast. So these are the methods of breast reconstruction. After that, lots and lots of questions are asked about breast cancer, about the recent advancements in breast cancer. So see the latest pattern of questions regarding breast cancer. First, this question is very important. Nottingham prognostic index. So what is this Nottingham prognostic index?
the formula Nottingham Prognostic Index is NPI is equal to 0.2 into tumor size plus lymph node stage plus tumor grade. And this is calculated to select the patients for adjuvant treatment. After that question is asked about Nottingham Prognostic Index, after that question is asked about Bloom-Richardson grading. This question was asked in pathology. Bloom-Richardson grading. There are three components. Mnemonic is TNM. T, tubule formation. N, nuclear pleomorphism. And M, mitosis. After that, question was asked about multi-gene test in the breast cancer. So see, what are those multi-gene tests? Multi-gene test in breast cancer. Predict the likelihood of survival. Likelihood of survival. Likelihood of recurrence rate or recurrence. And likelihood of responsiveness to chemotherapy. Based on expression of multiple genes. I'm repeating, multi-gene tests predict the likelihood of survival, likelihood of recurrence rate, and responsiveness to chemotherapy based on expression of multiple genes. So what are those multi-gene tests generally used? Multi-gene test. On the basis of expression of multiple genes, multi-gene tests are used to predict responsiveness to chemotherapy, used to predict the survival and recurrence rate in patients of breast cancer. So, multi-gene test on the basis of expression of multiple genes used to predict survival recurrence rate and likelihood of responsiveness to chemotherapy. What are the names of tests which are used? First, Oncotype DX. Question is asked, in Oncotype DX, how many genes are assessed? 21 genes. Second is PAM50. How many genes are assessed? 50 genes. And third is MAMMA print. In MAMMA print, total 70 genes are assessed. So these are multi-gene tests. On the basis of expressions of genes, these tests are used to predict survival, recurrence rate, and likelihood of responsiveness to chemotherapy. We are going to discuss in detail this Oncotype DX. Now see, it is going to predict survival, responsiveness to chemotherapy, and recurrence rate in a breast cancer patient. who is node negative. The ERPR means estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor is positive, and HER2 new receptor is negative. So this is oncotype DX. Not only for breast, oncotype DX is also used for colon and prostate. So oncotype DX is a multi-gene test which is used for carcinoma colon, carcinoma prostate and carcinoma breast. There is another very, very important topic which is frequently asked nowadays in most of the exams, and that is molecular classification of breast cancer. So molecular classification of breast cancer is based on gene expression profiling. It is also known as luminal criteria. So according to gene expression profiling or according to molecular classification, what are the types of breast cancer? First is luminal A or LUM-A. This is ER positive, this is PR positive and HER2 new negative. Now you can easily see that this is double positive. And since it is having ERPR positive, HER2 new negative, this one is associated with best prognosis. And be careful, this is the most common type. LUM-A. Second, luminal B or LUM-B. In this, ER positive, PR positive and HER2 new positive. So what should be the name? The name should be triple positive breast cancer. After that, third type, normal breast-like. This one is ER positive and it is well differentiated. ER positive and it is well differentiated. Fourth type is basal cell type. This is very, very important. Now see, it is also known as triple negative. So why it is known as triple negative? Because it is ER negative, PR negative and HER2 new negative. So it is negative for ER, PR, HER2 new. But it is positive for myoepithelial markers and cytokeratins. You have to remember cytokeratin 5, 6, 17 and EGFR. I'm repeating. Basal cell type or triple negative is positive for myoepithelial markers, cytokeratins, cytokeratin 5, 6, 17 and EGFR. And fifth is HER2 new type. So answer is simple, HER2 new type. In this, ER is negative, PR negative, only HER2 new is positive. So this is very important Nowadays, it is frequently asked. There is another recent advancement or latest pattern of question being asked is when is prognostic index? In short, it is known as VNPI. Usually, in patients of ductal carcinoma in situ, DCIS, the treatment is wide local excision, usually, and that is sufficient. Only some patients require radiotherapy after excision. So this VNPI or Van Nuys prognostic index is to select the patients in which there is no requirement of radiotherapy. There is no requirement of radiotherapy. It means surgical excision is sufficient. And it is based on how to remember the mnemonic is SWAG. It is based on SWAG. S, size of lesion. W, width of margin. A, age of patient. G, grade of tumor. And apart from SWAG, you must be knowing that in DCIS there is microcalcification. So it is based on SWAG plus microcalcification, and this is very, very important. After that, nowadays you have seen that lots and lots of questions are being asked about BRCA, BRCA1 and BRCA2. So have a look. BRCA1 and BRCA2. First question, what is the location of BRCA1? It is on chromosome number 17 and BRCA2 13. There are similarities between these two. What are the similarities between these two? First, patients are young patient. Second, there is increased risk of bilateral breast cancer. And third, the type is invasive ductal cancer. These are the similarities. But what are the differences? You can see this one is hormone receptor negative and this is poorly differentiated. Whereas BRCA2 is hormone receptor positive and it is well differentiated. After that, I told you that BRCA1 is mainly responsible for breast cancer in females. So I told you, ladies first. So it is mainly responsible for female breast cancer and BRCA2 mainly responsible for male breast cancer. Apart from breast cancer, what are the other malignancies whose risk is increased in BRCA1 mutation? Mnemonic is OCP. O, ovary. C, colon. And P, prostate. Whereas in BRCA2, it is OCP and GSM. O, again same, ovary, colon, prostate and pancreas. G, gallbladder. S, stomach. And M, melanoma. So there is increased risk of ovary, colon, prostate, pancreas, gallbladder, stomach, melanoma in BRCA2 mutation. Questions are asked, suppose patient is having BRCA1 mutation, what is the lifetime risk of development of breast cancer? And what is the lifetime risk of development of ovarian cancer? So see, lifetime risk of development of breast cancer. is 60 to 80%. And lifetime risk of development of ovarian cancer is 30 to 40%. It's a very important question, I'm repeating. In BRCA1 mutation patients, lifetime risk of breast cancer is 60 to 80% and ovarian cancer is 30 to 40%. This is breast cancer.